So we assume that the first concept of petrification, of petrification in two ways. The first, more immediate and somewhat trivial, is the use of durable materials versus more perishable ones. And the second is conceptual and related to societies, so structuration versus destructuration. We selected two focus on portable materials, and more specifically on human feelings, anthropomorphic feelings, which are characterized by the use of different materials. It is clear that that is, introduces at least a couple of problems. The first one is the availability of materials and the suitability for shaping. Second, shapeable materials that may have disappeared, reducing the record, or leaving us only the durable part of multi-material objects. Anthropomorphic feelings span all over the world, over a wide period of time and all over the world, with interesting phases of abundance versus scarcity and even absence. At least since the Upper Paleolithic, we can recognize structured and pattern anthropomorphic figures, let's say petrified. Afterwards, it is well known that the Neolithic is a period of particular movements. Indeed, the topic of figurines particularly slippery, and it involves assumption about the self-conceptions of humans and their artistic and rigid beliefs. This debate finally consolidated, petrified again, in the classical vision of the mother goddess cult, best exemplified by the writing of Mariakin Butas, who was born here in Vilnius 95 years ago. This concept has been anyway the subject of the radical criticism that we touch up but won't discuss here. However, we believe that such a complex record of figurations can give interesting hints for a debate on petrification societies, both in the trivial meaning of materialistic durability and in the conceptual meaning about social consolidations, as proposed by the session organizer. But what material is really durable or instead perishable? Stone is hard, but also soft stones exist, like jet, lignite, and some chalks and marks, and wood is perishable, but also mud and unbaked clay. And how to consider baked clay or pottery and bone or ivory? In fact, pottery is a material more durable than many organic ones, representing a sort of petrification in this aspect. But what should we say of figurines made of our animal matter, like ivory and bone? How much petrified should they be considered? Well, we should see that the fine context may help at least in part. And we will present three main case studies: the Russian Upper Paleolithic, Sardinian Neolithic and Neolithic, and Egyptian pre-dynastic figurines, encompassing around 25,000 years of different situations, from hunter and gatherers until the formation of an empire. For the Eurasian Upper Paleolithic, about 200 wall of fragmentary figurines can be observed, from 30,000 to 15,000 BC. Material used are different in different areas, and environmental constraints could have influenced the choices, as possibly shown by prevailing ivory or the eastern steppes. The anthropomorphic imagery displays a clear typological structuration. A fundamental theme is substantially shared, sometimes like the concept of woman, as Richard Leger remarked in 2011. In the Gravitian and the Magdalenian phases, figures are not from funeral contexts and they show notable concentrations on sites. Prevailing materials are stone and ivory, petrified again, but baked clay pop-ups in different phases when used for both animal and anthropomorphic figurines from Siberia to North Africa. Particularly in the early Gravitian and in the Central European Pavlovian context, baked clay seems to have been used for ritual purposes, apparently implying the deliberate fragmentation of figurines during pyrotosis, as proposed by Bandi da Retali in 1989. Puzzles are fragments of long feelings, and some of them certainly anthropomorphic ones, have been recovered from few sites like Donny Vespucci. In this site, the famous wall figurine was associated with hundreds of fragments inside a hat with the baking head. The black by baking ritual interpretation has been debated, but it has also been suggested that other damage seen in different sites on soft stone figurines could have had a similar relation with some sort of damaging rituals. Therefore, rituals would have been applied to destructure the artifact concept of the feminine, making use of the transformational characteristic of plain being baked. Other petrified objects were instead produced in stone and then in ivory, as intended to last. There's been a Neolithic and a Neolithic case. Neolithic Western Europe is characterized by the massive use of stones for figurines, at least in the present state of the research, where graves and caves have been the main sources for figurines. Sven Hansen, in his impressive work on human imagery in Stone Age, identified this situation for the Iberian Peninsula, but this observation can be extended also to Sardinia, where a total of 148 figurines span about 5,000 to 2,800 BCE, that is from Bormidino in the Neolithic to Avealsu Filicosa in the Neolithic. The typology of figurines is structured with well-defined iconographies in the earliest phases. A basic distinction can be outlined, showing a trend correlation of raw materials and context. Settlements have a higher frequency of potent figurines. In fact, in the intermediate phases considered, San Ciriaco and Mezzieri, more settlements have been investigated and pottery shows a higher frequency than stone. The dichotomy between clay and petrified materials is here particularly clear. We pass now to the case of the Egyptian Pelinastic, span from about 4,400 to 3,000 BCE, that is Badari to Nagara period, corresponds to the growth of complexity in Egypt and ultimately of regality, and to the foundation of the Egyptian kingdom of the empire. Pre-dynastic context faced a long season to approximate excavation and looting since the 19th century. Many figurines thus entered the archaeological trade market and also some fakes. Only about half of the 308 figurines available for the time span have a reliable context. 160 items with new excavation provide an important set of data. The majority of these are made of mud or unfired clay, sometimes shaped around a wooden stick or cane, both for settlements and cemeteries. Some old excavations, like Tigris Nagada, and recent excavations, such as Abydos Cemetery by Atkin and colleagues, show how high the risk is of loss of such fragile and baked figurines due to deformation processes and recovering techniques. Stone, ivory, and bone figurines come out in small numbers, and only from the cemeteries that were the object of the quoted earliest excavation and looting. Generally speaking, figurines from settlements are more often made of mud and clay, often unbaked, while the cemetery may display some more durable items, as identified also by the site of Elma Aslan near Abydos, with data from both settlement and cemetery. Figurines show the prominence of the female subjects, but include a relevant proportion of males, often with a beard. While occurring the same variety of materials, make figurines show a higher proportion of ivory and the only use of gold. Lastly, where the early phase of Nagada display this diversified presence of subjects, figurines tend to disappear in the latest phases of the Nagada period, when we clearly see the development of specific figuration of bald-headed males with a fuzzy sheath. In the same phase, the start of a real statuary with similar subject is suggested by the golden figure from Tel El Farka in the Nile Delta and by fragments of a stone statue from the Heracleopolis Cemetery. At the onset of dynastic times, the statues of the Coptos Colossi, located 10 kilometers away from Nagada, are the marker of this transition from a diversified expression of figuration to a formalized male-centered iconography. To conclude, setting apart the warnings about the formation prophecies of the archaeological record, some simple conclusion can be drawn. Settlement displays a wide variety of material, but they are particularly rich in unbaked and baked clay objects, indeed already in some cases dating to the Paleolithic. Caves and graves tend to have a different profile, more petrified. 2. The transformational transient state of clay seems to be a factor of interest. 3. Figurines face cycles of high diversity and frequency, and phase of the reduced production and profuse. In some cases, like in dynastic Egypt, we can trace the emergence of the fine figuration and statuary connected to developing power and ultimately a stone state, following phases of redundancy of figurative subjects. 4th and last one. In other cases, the crisis in the human refiguration correspond to the emergence of symbolic representation, like in Southeast Europe at the end of the Copper Age, as underlined by Hans in 2007. In Sardinia, after the Neolithic Copper Age recedence, during the early to the late Bronze Age, the human refiguration seems absent. In these cases, the issue is certainly not state formation, but we believe that social issue should be considered as
relevant as well.
That is. Thank you.